Just doesn't make any sense. Some might think that since the world of the word of the cross is falling to their ears, they have to find some other truth out there, you know, something that makes more sense, some way they can control God. And many of you went through that stage. I went through that stage. There's a time in my life I walked through that desert known as spirituality without faith, swept over by a tide of august verbiage, mistaking resignation for commitment, hearing and following a gospel of not how we ought to treat others, but how we should become therapists to ourselves, how we can become our own gods. But then Paul goes on to say, when I became a man, I gave up childish ways. And indeed, there's a time when we need to move from being children of God to becoming mature sons and daughters of God, to have an adult faith. And that's where the Corinthians are when Paul wrote this letter to them that we heard in our second reading. In 146 BC, the Romans destroyed the city of Corinth in a punitive expedition. But in 44 BC, the Romans rebuilt the city and sent the dregs of the surplus population from Rome itself to settle there. Kind of like how England sent criminals over to Australia to populate the continent, same kind of thing. But Corinth quickly developed into a hub of east-west trade in the empire and a center of Roman imperial culture. So by the time that Paul wrote this letter, his congregation had money and they had education. But like many first-generation children, they didn't want to do anything that would make them look foolish in the eyes of others. I mean, they were being exposed to cultures and religions from all over the known world, but they were still thinking like children in the Christian faith. So he tried to explain things to them like thinking adults. He wrote, But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block for Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles, but to those who are called, both Jew and Greek, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Now we had a tough road to hoe with these baby Christians. And even today, you get people to believe in Jesus, the teacher, one who adds a few pearls of wisdom into the treasury of Western religious thought, you know, like the pearls of wisdom that we just heard from the Sermon on the Mount. But Jesus, the crucified Messiah, Jesus, the one who died for us, well, that's an entirely different story altogether. Give me proof, people say. What makes Christianity more special than any other religion? Compare them. They all got good things in them. I want proof. I want proof that there's something more special in Christianity than there is in any other line of religious thought. Now, I've said this before, but I'm going to say it again. When it comes to Christianity, I am an unabashed chauvinist. Okay? I believe with all my heart and all my soul that Jesus Christ and Christ alone is the way, the truth, and the life. But people always want to compare and contrast religions. So, let me look at a few, okay? For example, you probably heard or read about how Muhammad had claimed the truth had been revealed to him by the angel Gabriel, and he was said to receive wisdom, and so the Quran was written. Now, Joseph Smith, from the founder of Latter-day Saints, said the same kind of thing, but for him, it was the angel Moroni. Siddhartha Gautama, the father of Buddhism, based his authority on having achieved nirvana and bodhi. Now, note the founder of Sikhism said that he had a mystical experience in which he reached heaven and spoke with a god named Satnam. Lao Tzu, the father of Taoism, and Confucius, the father of Confucianism, simply claimed to know the truth based on their own acquired wisdom. And thousands of other groups claim to have truth has been revealed by everything from angels to space aliens to inner selves and ascended masters. Now, the founders of Hinduism and Shinto are unknown, and that leaves them to stand entirely on the merits of their own teachings. Therefore, we have nothing on which to base our decisions about the truth of any of these religions except what the founder of their religion said. To stand or fall on something that no one can prove or disprove. But Christianity, that's different. Christianity isn't based on what Jesus said, an angel told him. It isn't even based upon a spiritual truth that he himself revealed. It is based on who he was and is, the Messiah. The Messiah and what he did to prove it. He died and he rose on the third day. Jesus states his whole claim to authority on who he is and on his resurrection. And everything else he said and did stands or falls on that claim. Since the very beginning, Jesus, belief in Jesus' resurrection has formed the very core of Christian teachings. And I remind you that the followers of Jesus weren't telling people about what happened in some heavenly realm. They didn't talk about what happened on Mount Olympus or some far-off land. There's no once upon a time in their story. These people lived through it. And if Jesus' resurrection hadn't happened, if the body of Christ were not, in fact, missing from the grave, then all anyone had to do to disprove it and discredit the apostles is just simply go to the tomb. All the Jewish and Roman authorities had to do was in order to crush the infant Christian religion was simply produce the body. Well, what if the apostles had just removed the body and hid it? Some might ask. Well, number one, the Bible says Roman soldiers guarded the tomb. But even if the apostles had removed the body, would such of those who did follow Jesus, fishermen, carpenters, tax collectors, etc., or any men for that matter, and women for that matter, would they have willingly been tortured and killed as martyrs for something that they knew was a lie? Remember, I'm not talking about those who came later on and believed because of what they've been told. These are people who, if the resurrection was a lie, they would have known it. No, these people were people who said they had seen Jesus' resurrection from the dead and chose to die themselves rather than change their story. Now, some people may be willing to die for what they believe, but no one gives up their life for something that they know to be a lie. Again, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles, but to those who are the called, both Jews and non-Jews, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Jesus Christ died on the cross for us and for our sins. Is that offensive to our intellectual sensibilities? Well, as human beings, the answer is yes. It is offensive to us. It doesn't make any sense to us. But it also is good news. It is great news. Because it means that no matter who we are or what we've done in the past, Christ still died for us, for you, for all of you, for me. And all we need to do is to have faith in our Lord and Savior, the risen Messiah, Jesus Christ. That's the faith that we confess each Sunday. It's the faith into which we baptize. It's the faith in which we all believe that Jesus Christ is truly the way, the truth, and the life. Thanks be to God that the Holy Spirit gives us the faith to believe. As Martin Luther once said, the faith to believe that this is most certainly true. Amen.